Hi guys, I'd like to welcome all of us to our channel of Honest Sciences and Mathematics TV channel. So today we are going to look at the shapes of atomic orbitals. And this basically is a follow-up from our previous discussion we had seen on the quantum mechanical model of an atom that we had looked into, whereby we see that different scientists, there were some historical context, there were different scientists who had contributed basically to the idea of the quantum mechanical model of an atom, whereby we saw that especially the concept of the orbitals was advanced by Erwin Schrödinger, who basically suggested that an electron wave give different forms or patterns that are known as orbitals, which have characteristic energies. And in a sense, of course, we have defined the concept of an orbital basically as a volume in space within which electrons with a particular energy are likely to be found. So in this sense, we are going to see also that for us to appreciate this particular case, and having said that from the quantum mechanical model, we can be able to describe an electron as a wave. Therefore, for us to pinpoint this particular place that these particular electrons can be found, we are given different ideas, especially on the electronic configuration, which we have discussed in a different video. But in that case, of course, that did not give us specifically how we can be able to identify the shapes of these different orbitals. Therefore, in a sense, we are going to look at this particular electron cloud that we are referring to as orbitals, and how we can be able to identify these different types of energy. Now, hearing this contribution, of course, suggested about a volume in space where there's a possibility of finding these electrons with a particular energy. But basically, it did not give us an insight in our discussion on how we can be able to identify shapes of these various orbitals. Now, in a sense, we had said that we have different quantum numbers, and we had mentioned that the angular momentum quantum number will assist us to describe basically the subshells that we have said, which are a derivative of the principal quantum number. And these subshells basically are the ones that we had referred to as orbitals. Now, we said that this principal quantum number can be shown to be given as L and then negative L. Now, we'll include a positive here for the sake of clarity. So the general angular momentum number is a range of numbers that range between 0 and basically this was that's wrong. So basically this was given as L angular momentum number is ranging from 0 to a number n minus 1, where n is the principal quantum number. Therefore, from this particular derivative principal quantum number, we have listed a few conditions or a few ways in which we can be able to represent L, which is an angular momentum, a quantum number from N. And we said that if the value of N is equals to 1, then therefore we are going to have the angular momentum being represented as 0. And then we said that if N is equals to in that respect, then therefore the angular momentum number is going to be 0 or 1. And then 3L is equals to 0, 1, 2. And then for 4, and L is equals to 0, 1, 2, 3. And in that respect, of course, that one is the order in which we had listed that. And basically from this, this had given us a clue on how we can be able to identify this as specific numbers, whereby we said in the case of L is equals 1, this basically represents the S subshell, which are basically the atomic orbitals we had said. So this is a P, a D, and F subshells respectively. And these are the orbitals that we had, of course, mentioned. If we try to look at this assignment of these specific letters, they are different. Therefore, they are denoting different atomic orbitals, which of course are going to be given. And thereafter, we proceeded to give a description of a magnetic quantum number which described the alignment of orbitals along the axis. And this basically gave us the number of orbitals for each subshell in, of course, this discussion that we have done. So for today, basically, we're going to look at the shape of different orbitals that I've mentioned here, which is going to shed a light on how we can be able to identify the S, P, D, and perhaps the F orbitals from our next discussion that is going to, of course, proceed this. Now, the shapes of atomic orbitals are given by the angular quantum numbers I've just demonstrated, and they are derived from the extent of the deviation of the orbitals, of course, from which is an electron cloud with respect to the nucleus. So therefore, as we're going to demonstrate on different shapes of orbitals, we're going to have in mind that this deviation of the electron cloud from the nucleus, which of course is going to represent these various energies. Now, in a sense, an electron in the S orbital. So as we say, we have S, P, D, and F orbitals. For that case, we have mentioned the concept of a G, but we are basically going to look at the first three sets. Perhaps if you have time, we can look at the fourth one. But for now, we are going to look at the first one, which is the S orbital, and how we can be able to illustrate or how it can be represented insofar as its shape is concerned. Therefore, an electron in the S orbitals forms an electron cloud that is going to be equidistant from the nucleus. And in us referring to the concept of equidistant from the nucleus from basic geometry, then therefore we're going to see that if the nucleus is centrally located, then the distance that is equidistant is going to form a geometrically spherical shape. So perhaps I cannot be able to represent a three-dimensional structure from this. But suppose this is our point of the central point from this particular case, and I have an axis at this specific point, then we're going to see that an area, a volume that is going to encompass an equal distance from the center, therefore is going to form a spherical shape. And therefore, if the electron cloud for the S orbital is equidistant on all directions from the nucleus, then therefore it's going to appear as a spherical shape. Therefore, the S orbital that we are going to demonstrate to illustrate later in our discussions is going to assume a spherical shape. And then next we had talked about the P orbital. And in our case for the P orbital, it is going to have a dumbbell shape. We had of course roughly illustrated this P orbital and said that if we have this particular plane, just going to illustrate it on three different sets, and then later perhaps we can have just a central. This is X, Y, and this is a, of course I can just have one like this. So this is an X, X, Y, and Z. Now for the D orbital, we're going to see that the orbitals have got a dumbbell shape, whereby each line of the axis has got its individual orbital. Now, if we have a dumbbell shape of this particular orbital appearing like this, then the alignment of this particular orbital on the x-axis is going to appear like this. And therefore, this is going to be referred to as the px orbital. And in case if it's aligned along the z-axis, then this is going to be referred to as the pz orbital. And this is the px orbital. And if it's aligned along the y-axis, then this is going to be referred to as the PY orbital. Therefore, for the P orbital, it's going to assume these three different shapes. So in any case, if we try to illustrate the concept of a PZ, PX, and PY orbital, then it will be understandable for us or a comprehensive that this is lying along a specific axis. And in that particular respect, we're going to also to look at, this is orbital number two. So the third one that we're going to look at is the D orbital. I'm trying to see how it can be able to be illustrated. So this is a d orbital, and for the d orbital, it'll have a general shape of a cloth leaf shape. Now for the d orbital, we are going to see that it will lie in both planes and axes of the x, y, z dimensions, and they are named depending on the axis and planes whereby they are having that particular alignment. So in any case, if I just have this x, y, z, therefore I can be able to show the orbital which is going to be given as the d orbital lying along the x, y plane, or still I can be able to illustrate that one as an orbital that is lying along the z, y plane as such. So in any case, if I try to put this one in the perspective, then I'm going to have this one given as this glove shape, and then it's going to appear as this one. So that is going to represent the d orbital, which is lying along the z, y plane. So this one I had given earlier demonstration in one of our videos on one of the discussions that we had. And in that particular discussion, we have just had a mention of these specific orbitals, whereby we said that we can be able to illustrate this one still using this particular shape. So still I'm going to have my axis represented as such. So therefore, if I have an orbital which is lying along the x, the y plane, then it's lying along the axis and still on the xy plane and the xy axis. So therefore, this orbital can be, of course, given a particular illustration whereby we are having a d x y orbital given as such. So therefore, we're going to see other illustrations which are going to follow from this. Of course, we're going to also to see other orbitals like the f orbital, which is going to also to have a different shape from this. But for the f orbital, it's going to have this particular electron clouds protruding towards the spaces between the planes, rather the spaces between the axes, which of course x, y, z. Now for the f orbital, we're going to have two particular shapes protruding into the spaces in between this particular axis, and it's going to appear. I know that we can not be able to illustrate a three-dimensional illustration on this particular case, but this is how we're going to represent the f, x, y, z orbital in this particular case. This is an orbital. Now that one is going to be elaborate. Perhaps I'm going to do one of the illustrations, so using the projection of this three-dimensional figure, if I find an appropriate illustration. So we'll just stop that one at that particular point. So next we're going to look at hybridization of different atomic orbitals, and that one is going to give us a sense on how these particular compounds with atomic orbitals are forming other particular elements with atomic orbitals are forming compounds and interacting with others to form different species of chemicals. So that is it for now. I hope that we have understood how we can be able to represent different shapes of atomic orbitals that we have mentioned in this specific video. So if we have an S orbital, definitely that is going to give us a sense of a spherical shape that is equidistant. And this is a dumbbell shape for the B orbitals, it's a cloth leaf shaped for the D orbitals, and then for this one, F orbital, we're going to illustrate it using these particular shapes which are projecting towards the spaces in between the axes, which has said that for a three-dimensional object, perhaps a clearer picture, we can be able to visualize that. So that is it for now, guys. Bye. Let's catch up in our next video on hybridization of atomic orbitals.